Let's start with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you again to have this opportunity to come together. We thank you for this book, your word, that we have it, that we can study it, and that most of all, we get to see you in it. It's all about Jesus from beginning to end, and we get to look into it, and we get to see him, and through him we see you, because he is your exact image and likeness, and we just get this beautiful picture of how awesome and holy and good and beautiful you are. Thank you for this opportunity. Speak to each one of us here. You know what we came in with. You know what we came in needing. And you're just that awesome, beautiful God that cares about each one of us. And so speak to each one of us. And just send us out of here overjoyed to have been in the presence of Jesus. And all this we ask in the beautiful, holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
You know, I was fine right till it was time to start. So, Luke chapter 2, we'll be starting in verse 1. And while you turn it, I will begin reading. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them at the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, as it was told them. Feels a little weird to be doing this at this time of year, doesn't it? But we are on a chronological progression through the Gospels, and we are at an important moment, a very important moment. If the death, burial, and resurrection, looked at as one event, is the most important event in Christian faith, and it is, then this is the second most important. The virgin birth of Jesus Christ, the coming of the Messiah to the earth, God entering human history in the flesh.
Probably the right time of year, though.
Possibly. I could.
Yeah.
Possibly. I'm thinking it was October, November, but that's just me. I have good reason for that.
Okay.
So, why is the virgin birth so important? At least two reasons that I want to get into tonight. First, originally God was made in the image. Man was made. God, why the hell is that? Man was made in the image of God, and they fell, and his spirit died. And every succeeding human through his father was subject to sin. Taking the human father out of it allows this child to be born without original sin. And that is huge. It is God going back and almost starting all over again. Just as he reached down into the dirt and formed the first man, he reached down through his spirit and formed this second Adam in her womb. We see this in Genesis chapter 5, verses 1 through 3. This is the book of the genealogy of Adam. In the day that God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. He created them male and female and blessed them and called them mankind in the day they were created. And Adam lived 130 years and begot a son in his own likeness. No longer in the likeness of God. They had fallen. The spirit had died. God said, if you eat of this tree, you will surely die. He didn't die physically. God's not a liar. Something died. It was the spirit. It was the breath of God that had been breathed into this man.
Mm-hmm.
Was gone. And God is setting all that straight. Beginning here. It also fulfills the proto-evangelium. This is the first mention of the gospel. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, God is speaking to the devil, Satan, the serpent, and between your seed and her seed, he shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. This is a document given to Hebrew people, written by Hebrew people. No one is the seed of a woman. Everyone is the seed of the Father. We looked at so many genealogies, begot by, begot by, begot by, begot by. Even the one that included women, it was the wife of, begot by, through. So this is either a huge mistake or God was trying to say something, that there would be no father, that it would be a virgin birth. And this is the very first prophecy of the coming of Jesus. And so the virgin birth fulfills the very first prophecy of the coming, and it was distinct. Her seed, not his seed, not even God's seed, her seed. It would come from a woman minus a father. So, kind of keep those things in mind as we begin to look at this passage. Beginning in verse 1, and it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. Caesar Augustus, the first emperor of Rome. Prior to this, Julius Caesar, Rome had been a republic. They had strong leaders, but it had been a republic. The death of Julius Caesar, the murder, led to his adopted son, Caesar Augustus, seizing power and creating an empire. He was king. He was in charge. He was it. He came to power in 31 BC after a period of turmoil following the death of his adopted father, Julius Caesar. At this point in the world, in history, the Roman Empire had extended as far as it ever would. It had reached the height of its power. It circled the entire Mediterranean Ocean. This includes beginning with what would today be Iran and moving east. It occupied Turkey, Greece, Italy, and Spain to the Atlantic coast. Heading north, it included France, Germany, and the majority of the island of Britain. In the Middle East, it ruled over Syria, Lebanon, and Israel. To the south, it ruled the entire Mediterranean coast of northern Africa, including most of Egypt. They were huge. They were powerful. They were big. The Romans, in fact, called their kingdom Terram Orbis Imperium, the empire of the whole earth, which correlates back to our first verse, that all the world should be registered. They were a little arrogant too. But all of the civilized world was under their power, and if they didn't directly control them, they were so dependent on Rome for trade. They controlled the Mediterranean, they controlled trade routes to Africa, they controlled trade routes to Asia. They were it. So even if you weren't directly under their power, you were so dependent upon them, you might as well have been under them. But at this point, they were experiencing, I'm going to come back to that point. Daniel, in the book of Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar has a dream about power and losing power. And there's a statue, and there's a gold head and a bronze chest and iron, and each one of them represented a different period of time, a different empire or kingdom. The gold head, of course, being Nebuchadnezzar and working down. And in Daniel 2:44, the fourth kingdom is when he said the Messiah would come. The fourth kingdom was the empire of Rome. Just exactly as God had predicted, Jesus steps onto the scene. At this time, Rome was experiencing relative peace. There were small skirmishes, there were a few things going on, but they were not actively at war with anyone. The Greek-Roman, Greco-Roman god of war, Janus, his temple, symbolically the doors had been closed. We're at peace, we're not at war. Everything's kind of cool right now. This became known as a period of time called Pax Romanos, peace of Rome. But it was also kind of a philosophy, a way of rule. In the places that they controlled, they dictated some things, much like our federal government does today. They tell us how to build roads, how to build roads, how to do schools, how to they imposed a lot of things. Chief among them, road building, and business was only done in the Greek language, period. If you had any dealings with Rome, if there were any contracts to be signed, if there were any transactions to take place, it had to be done in the Greek language. So how does all this affect? Why is this important to Jesus? In Galatians 4:4, it said that, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. God had a time frame and a plan of when Jesus was coming, of when he would send his son himself into the world, when he would become part of human history. And this was the perfect time. There were things going on here that made the spread of Christianity possible. The fact that there was a common language meant that the message of Jesus could go all over the known world. Even if they still spoke their native language, they had to learn Greek. So now you've got people who know Greek and a native language. You have tons of bilingual people who can take the gospel and translate it into other languages. The fact that Rome had forced the Greek language on the world deliberately contributed to the rapid spread of Christianity. It also allowed travel. There were tons of trade routes and seaports that didn't exist before. Rome built all of these. There was a road system. There had never been a road system. There were trails and camel routes and little two tracks, single tracks in the dirt, and robbers and thieves. But the power of Rome had made travel relatively safe, so people could carry that gospel to other parts of the world. They could get on a ship and a couple days later wind up in a completely different country where they spoke at least somewhat well a common language, and they could instantly start sharing the gospel. God knew exactly when to bring Jesus into the world. Had this happened 60, 100 years earlier, Christianity might have been just a heretical sect of the Jewish faith that went nowhere. In the fullness of time, God's plan, He chose beautifully when to bring Jesus into the world. Verse 2, this census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. If you do some deep digging, there is some debate. Some people want to say that Luke got this aspect wrong because they think Quirinius served during a period that would have made all of this not work. There's been a lot of new scientific discoveries, new archaeological discoveries, and it's turning out that Quirinius served two terms as the governor of Syria, and that time frame would have fit in perfectly. And the second, there's Luke actually notes a second, not in the book of Luke, but in Acts 5:37, Luke actually notes the second census that Quirinius taken would have, which would have also been during his second term as governor of Syria. So every single time they try to disprove the Bible, and it's constant. It's constant. It's like people have nothing better to do. Fine, you don't believe in God, you don't believe in Jesus, go about your business. Why would you spend all of your time trying to disprove what other people believe?
Right.
But every single time they try to, God always wins. Yes. For years, since the higher critics in the 1800s, there's no proof that Pontius Pilate ever existed. And then they found a plaque, a big stone plaque that you can't deny with his name on it in Israel. So, you know, it gets people thinking, it gets people asking questions. I wonder why God doesn't lightning bolt some of these people, but he doesn't. So the Bible is always vindicated, always. Verses 3 and 4. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. Last week we went through both of the genealogies and how important they were, and I mentioned that they were a matter of public record. Where would they be kept? In the town you were born. More specifically, Bethlehem was the city of David, the birthplace of David. David being in Joseph's line would have been the top guy, so the genealogy would have been kept from David to Joseph, so it would be kept in his city. Again, people want to debate, why would they have to go? That's what the Jews did. Genealogy, lineage was incredibly important to them. They kept track of it. It was how they proved they were Jews. It was how they proved what tribe they came from. It was terribly important to them. It was a matter of public record, and that was the best place to send them back to do a census. And so they went back. Why Bethlehem? Why have Jesus born in Bethlehem? Several reasons. First, it was prophecy. Micah 5:2, but you, Bethlehem, Ephrath, though you are little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth are from old, from everlasting. This was written after the death of David. It couldn't possibly have been about David. This was a prophetic. And it was well known. When the Magi come to Herod and want to know where the new king is, that they we're going to look at that next week. They ask, you know, where was he born? And Herod goes to the priest right off the top of their head. Bethlehem, Micah 5, it's there in Micah 5 too. Well, except they didn't have the 5:2 thing. It's in Micah. The Lord says that's where he's going to be, in Bethlehem. And the people knew it too. In John 7:42, when Jesus of Nazareth from Galilee was, people were talking, hey, this is the Messiah. And they're like, wait a minute, isn't the Messiah supposed to be born in Bethlehem? It was well-known prophecy. Jesus fulfilled it perfectly. Pictorially, it's also awesome. Bethlehem means the house of bread. John 6:32-33, then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Jesus, I'm bread. And also notice that Jesus also showing that the manna that came down from heaven was a picture of him. John 6:35, same passage. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. And finally, John 6:46-51, I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. So, why did Jesus come from Bethlehem? Because he is the bread of life, and he should come from the house of bread. There's some typological reasons, too. There were actually two cities within Hebrew culture that were referred to as the city of David. One was Bethlehem, and the other one was Zion, Mount Zion, right outside of Jerusalem. Jesus could have come to Mount Zion. This is where David sat on his throne in royal splendor. But he didn't. He chose to come from Bethlehem, where David worked as a lowly shepherd. In John 10:11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. John 10:14, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. Jesus chose to come to the lowly estate of David, not the high estate. But he will take the other place too. It's coming. Not yet. But in Revelation 14, then I looked and behold a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 having his Father's name written on their foreheads. Jesus will fulfill the full type of David. He will fulfill all of it. But this time he came as the lowly shepherd. Next time he's coming back with a slightly different attitude. We'll actually get into that more in a little bit. Verse 5, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. Now Mary and Joseph are traveling from Nazareth to Bethlehem. This is quite some distance. I would speculate 70 miles. 60, 70 miles. This is a long distance. Unmarried couples do not travel together in Jewish culture. That's bad. So the marriage had to have taken place. It had to, for them to be traveling together. So why does it say betrothed? And I think this goes back to what we looked at in Matthew. And did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son. He didn't touch her. So the marriage had not been consummated at this point. So he's listed as betrothed. They are married in every sense of the word, but it hasn't been consummated yet because Joseph was a righteous man. Verses 6 and 7. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered, and she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Hey, Joe, it's time. There's no room at the inn. So they wind up with the beasts of the field. We don't know for sure if this was some kind of barn, a lean-to, a structure attached to the inn, possibly some speculated a cave. There are a lot of caves in that area. But it was just someplace where animals hung out. And we only know the animals hung out there because there was a manger. A manger is just something you feed an animal out of. And we know they had to have been poor. If they had been rich and rolled up to that inn, somebody would have found them a room. Whether the innkeeper gave up his own room or kicked somebody out, if they had been well-to-do, they'd have had a room that night. But they weren't. They were poor. And Mary and Joseph are handling this completely on their own. There's no midwife. There's no family. Just little Mary and Joseph and amongst the animals in a field, in a cave, delivering a baby. The manger we talked about is simply a feeding trough made for animals. Most of what I've seen from that period, they were made of stone, carved out of the limestone over there, sandstone. Limestone is pretty easy to carve from. There aren't a whole lot of trees over there. So carving a feeding trough out of stone seems like a good idea, I guess. But the monumental step down that has just taken place is beyond comprehension. The creator of everything, and thus the owner of everything, every molecule of gold ever made, every diamond ever generated by this earth, every drop of silver, every gem, everything that we consider valuable belongs to him.
Amen.
And he laid it all down. He walked away from it all. Some of my favorite teachers, imagine if we suddenly left being a human and became an ant or a cockroach.
The ant.
Jesus' step down from heaven, from God to man, is a bigger step down than if we became ants or cockroaches. Mm-hmm. I threw in the cockroaches because I'm just that weird. They all said ants. So, what did he leave? I think one of the most beautiful pictures of the throne room of God, where Jesus sat before he made this little trip, is in Revelation chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. Immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven. And one sat on the throne, and he who sat there was like jasper, and a sardis stone in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne in appearance like an emerald. Around the throne, there were 24 thrones. And on the thrones, I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their heads. And from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices. Seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Before the throne, there was a sea of glass like crystal, and in the midst of the throne and around the throne were four living creatures full of eyes in the front and in back. And the first living creature was like a lion, the second living creature like a calf, and the third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within. And they do not rest day or night, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they will exist and were created." He sat on a throne surrounded by rainbows, with lampstands and a sea of glass, and his own amazing, indescribable creatures, day and night, telling him that you're worthy and you're holy, and the elders falling on their face and praising him. And now he's laying in a field, in a stone manger, surrounded by sheep and cattle and chicken. The biggest step down in history, and he did it voluntarily. What God gave up to vindicate his name and save our souls is beyond fathomable. Someday we're going to get a picture of it, because we're going to get to stand with him in a throne room and see that scene for ourselves. And maybe some of the other tears that Jesus will be wiping away in heaven will be when we realize just how far down he had to step to save us. Before we move on from here, notice again the inclusion of the word firstborn. Just like we saw in Matthew, the idea of the perpetual virginity of Mary just simply doesn't exist in the Bible. Why call it firstborn if she didn't have another one? Verse 8. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. I've seen some pictures from here. This area is actually under Palestinian rule, and so getting in and out of there is not always really nice. But I've seen pictures. And the fields are just amazing. Just spread out forever, and they're beautifully green, and there's little stones all over the place, little boulders, and it just spreads out all around the city of Bethlehem. And it's in these fields, the shepherds' fields around Bethlehem, that we find some shepherds. God could have chosen to announce the birth of the Messiah, of the Savior of the world, to anybody. There were priests just up the road. You can see Bethlehem from Jerusalem. You can see it. They put you up on a hill and you can look down. They even have a little wedding thing where you can get married overlooking the Bethlehem. And he could have come to Herod. They could have sent angels to Rome. Instead, it was announced to shepherds. In Jewish society, shepherds were almost the bottom rung of society. They were perhaps a step above tax collectors and prostitutes and lepers. Maybe a step above those three. And God chose to announce the birth of the Messiah to them. Why shepherds? I think because the baby that had come was going to so identify with what they do. Jesus, throughout the Gospels, is likened to a shepherd. And like these shepherds lived in the fields with their sheep, Jesus has come down to live with his sheep. Mm-hmm. Repeatedly we're referred to as Jesus' sheep. And he's come down, just like these shepherds lived out in the field with their sheep. He's come down to this earth to live among his sheep, to care for us, to love on us, to save us. Luke 9:58, and Jesus said to them, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Just like these shepherds living out in the fields, Jesus came down here and wandered around just taking care of the one thing that the sheep really needed, salvation. We also see a correlation again to David, because David is the king, and Jesus is the fulfillment of the perfect type of the king of Israel. In 1 Samuel 16:1-13, Samuel is told by God, Samuel the prophet, is told by God to go, "I'm done with Saul, I'm anointing a new king." And he goes to Bethlehem and goes to the house of Jesse, David's father, and he's like, "All right, God, must be this one." First son comes out, oldest. He's a spitting image of a man. He is just handsome and rugged and bold. And God's like, "No, don't go with what your eyes see. We're going on. That's what you got with Saul. We're going on God's economy with this one." And he goes through the next son, and the next son, and the next son, all seven of them. And God's like, "No, it's none of these." And Samuel's, "You got another one?" And where's David? He's out in the field with the sheep. He was so low on the totem pole, he wasn't even invited in for the sacrifice that Samuel had come to done. He's the runt. He's the literally red-headed child. It says he was, it said he was ruddy in appearance, which meant he had red hair. He was red skin. He was looked down upon. He wasn't even worthy to come into his father's table when a famous visiting prophet had come in. And isn't that the beautiful picture of our Lord? Left out, rejected, pushed away, not wanted. And yet he's out there doing what he's supposed to do, what needs to be done, taking care of the sheep. And so Samuel went through seven sons, and then David was the eighth, and eight is the number of new beginnings in the Bible. The whole shepherd picture also connects Jesus with the patriarch of the Israeli people, Jacob, who was later renamed Israel, and it's his 12 sons. Jacob was a shepherd. That was his thing. His father-in-law, and he got tons of sheep, and he was a conniver, but it's a direct connection to the Jewish people, and when they were taken into Egypt, and Joseph, tell them you're shepherds, because they'll leave you alone. Shepherds are looked down upon. Shepherds aren't loved. They're just, and this is who God chooses to announce. This is who God invites to the birthday of his son. It also connects us with Moses. What was Moses doing when God called him? He was out in the field taking care of sheep. It's a beautiful picture, and it's done over and over and over and over again in the Bible. And it's a picture of, I've actually raised sheep. I raised a ewe, and she had two lambs, and they're dumb. they are really not intelligent animals. And they're greasy. You know, you got to rub them in all that lanolin and their wool. There's not a whole lot attractive about a lamb, and it takes a, yeah, it's kind of a musty thing. It's all that oil and, but they wash up real nice. I mean, if you, because you scrub them down to show them off for the fair. But anyway, they clean up real nice. They clean up real nice. And isn't that another beautiful picture of Jesus? He washes us white as snow. So this beautiful picture of Jesus as a shepherd, and I think that's the huge connection here to Bethlehem and these shepherds, and it's just a constant beautiful picture of our relation to our Father, to our Savior. You know, we're the dumb sheep. We just keep screwing up, and we gotta keep. Before there was herding cats, there was herding sheep. they're almost as easy to get to work together. You know, there was, remember the parable of 100 sheep, and one of them, if 99 of your friends are over here, how does one get lost? How do you just get so oblivious to things that, how do you lose 99 of your friends and family? We're just not real smart, but Jesus loves us anyways, and he's come down. Verse 9, and behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Some commentators speculate that since Gabriel had been handling all the announcements up to this point, that this was most likely Gabriel. Can't be dogmatic about it, but Gabriel's on the scene. And what must angels look like? Everybody's always afraid. And it's going to be one of those things when we get, now I get it. They must be incredibly imposing figures. Verse 10, then the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. So we get the instant standard first words of an angel visit. Don't be afraid. But notice his words. He says, I bring you. Not everybody, not somebody, I bring you. He addresses them personally. These guys were looked down upon. They weren't really well liked in town. They probably didn't smell very good. Even if they managed to not, you know, lay down with the sheep, which was next to impossible. I mean, really, you're out in a field full of rocks. If you got the choice between putting your head on a rock and against a fuzzy sheep, which way are you going? Just saying.
And it's when it's cold, you just pull up another one.
Pull up another one.
These guys weren't really well liked in town. They weren't. And this angel addresses them directly. You. I bring to you. Good tidings. The word good tidings is euangelizo, which is where we get our word evangelize. Mm-hmm. He's bringing the good news. He's bringing the gospel, which will be to all people, but not tonight. Mm-hmm. Tonight, it's coming to you. The outcast, the dregs of society, the people everybody else looks down on. It's one thing when you want some lamb kebabs. Nobody thinks about the guy that was out there making sure when you're pulling up a wool rug or a wool blanket over you at night. Nobody's thinking about them poor shepherds that were out there making sure that could happen. But to this night, they were the most important people in the whole world. I bring to you. Eventually it's going to go to the whole world. And as great as this sounds, think it out with me. Angels, the word angel means messenger. These creatures are messengers from God. They carry messages from God. Hearing from an angel is the same as hearing from him who sent them. This night, they hear God himself say, I bring to you. God himself saying, I bring this gift to you. You outcasts, you losers, you. I've come for you. I'm starting at the bottom. I'm coming for those who are sick. I'm coming for those who are needed. He didn't announce to the priests or the kings or even the rich people in town. God himself, through his angels, saying, I came for you. Verse 11, for there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Again, notice the personal. For there is born to you this day in the city of David. I'm coming to the marginalized. I'm coming to those who think they don't matter. I'm changing the status of the world. I'm turning everything upside down. And I hope we all know at this point that Christ is Greek Christos, which means Messiah. Straight up, here it is. The Messiah has come. Verse 12, and this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. Why is this a sign? Does this sound like a sign? Because they've just been told that a Savior came, the Messiah, the promised seed of David. They would have known that the Messiah was the promised future king. A king should be born in a palace. A king should be born in a hospital, if they had hospitals back then. He should be born someplace other than a sheep field. He should be laying on a custom-built Messiah, King of the World, baby bassinet. He's laying in a stone feeding trough. Why is it a sign? Because this isn't where you would expect to find a king. Verses 13 and 14, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Heavenly host. Host is a military term. It means a gathered army, a large group put together. And when I looked up the definition, usually for aggressive or bad purposes, usually to attack, but not here. God sent his angelic army with a message of peace, a message of love. The war that has existed between God and man, the war propagated by sin, it's over. It's done. And he sent his army with this message of peace. John 3:17, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He sent his army to say, hey, the war's over. You don't need arms anymore. But things are going to change. Right now, God has sent his, Jesus is on a rescue mission behind enemy lines. And he's pulling out as many as he possibly can. But things are going to change. And things are going to go a little differently. Let's take a look at what it's going to look like, what these angels are going to be doing at the second coming. There is a point where God's grace and mercy comes to an end, where he says, I've waited long enough. Everybody who's going to come has come, and now it's time. Sin has to be punished. We are all sinners. It's either punished through Jesus for us, or we have to take the punishment ourselves. Those are the two choices. And those that choose not to allow Jesus to take that punishment for them, they're going to have a bad day. Revelation 19, 11 through 15. Now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a white robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, heavenly host, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. We've seen two pictures tonight of what Jesus is going to look like. But right now, he's coming to each and every one of us as the lowly shepherd of Bethlehem. He is already, was, and will be again the king sitting on the throne and the fierce warrior king coming to wipe out his enemies. But right now we have this beautiful time period where he's coming to all of us as the lowly shepherd of Bethlehem, saying, come, 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 come. Verses 15 and 16. So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in the manger, in a manger. So an angel starts talking to him, and then a whole bunch of angels fill the sky and start singing. After they left, how long do you think they stood there?
With their mouths open.
Just dumbfounded.
I've heard it pointed out that there's not a word, not a place in the Bible that says the angels ever sing. They speak, but they don't sing. Which is kind of sad. I'd like to think of them as being of singing.
Okay, I'm going with they sound so amazing that it's like a song.
There you go.
That fits my theology.
The praising.
So how long do you think they just stood there? Just dumbfounded and stupefied. Just. And so imagine their reaction when they regained their composure. They got to be pushing each other in the bushes. This is Uber. Did you see that? That was amazing. There's too many of us here. That was not bad lamb chops. This is. There's a bunch. That was awesome. Did you see that? And without hesitation, it says, with haste.
With haste.
They take off to check out what they'd been told. They had no doubt in what God had just told them. They accepted it beautifully. Reminds me of Joseph. So was there a frantic search, or did they just somehow know where to go? The text would tend to indicate that they just made a beeline for it, so maybe the angel gave them a little more information than is shared here.
Was there a star?
No. Not that we know of. It's not included in this portion of the text. Okay. It's coming up, but it's not mentioned here.
Okay.
Verses 17 and 18. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. This is how people react to an encounter with Jesus. Even a little baby Jesus in a stone manger in a field, it's an effect. It changes you. It does things to you. You can't help but share it. It's awesome. We see it with the woman at the well. First thing she did after encountering Jesus and hearing all the things he had, she ran to town. Come and see, look. Surely this must be the Messiah. He's told me everything I've ever done. The demoniac of Gadarenes, Jesus cast a legion of demons out of him. Lord, I want to go with you. No, I got a mission for you. You stay here and you spread my gospel. And he did. He became the first evangelist to the Decapolis, the 10 cities. We're going there. In Bethsaida, this beautiful Roman city, beautiful marble pillars, and in the middle of it all, there's one room that didn't quite get all destroyed, and there's a baptismal with a cross in the back, and church history holds that it was a church that was started by the demoniac of the Gadarenes. He couldn't help but tell people. Even when Jesus healed people, when Jesus talked to people, hey, keep it on the down low. And they run and tell people. It happens. It should happen if we've had an encounter with the living God. We should want to share it. We should not be able to help but share it. Ah. Verse 19. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. We're going to hear this said about Mary again. I made a slight allusion to this when we were talking about Mary. I'm not really sure that she knew exactly who she had given birth to. Gabriel had told her she was having a king, a Messiah. And the Jewish mindset and the descriptions he gave very much fit with the Jewish mindset of throwing off the yoke of Rome and setting up a kingdom now. And we see by some of Mary's later behavior that she didn't really get yet who Jesus was. And it wouldn't be until after he rose from the dead that she truly knew that she had given birth to God. She thought she was having a king. And so she kept so many of these things and pondered them in her heart. We're going to see this again. And this is Dr. Luke's account of the gospel. How could anybody possibly know that? I'm sure God could have directly downloaded it to him, but so solemnly do we see God work that way. He works through the natural and through people. I truly believe that Luke spent some beautiful, wonderful time sitting with Mary. And she told him directly, I didn't get it, but I kept it in my heart. I remembered, this shouldn't happen. We're poor people. We can't even afford a decent room to have our baby in. And shepherds show up out of nowhere saying that they've seen angels, a sky filled with angels, praising God. And they came to us, and they wanted just to see our baby. And they ran away praising and glorifying God for it. And how could Luke have heard about what the shepherds had seen, except that they came and told Mary? And Mary, and she didn't understand. She would. But gosh, what would it have been like to be Dr. Luke? To get to sit down with the mother of the Messiah and hear these amazing things. I don't know if we'll care then, but someday we will get to sit down with Mary too. And we will get to hear. We'll get to hear how this unfolded and how this went down. And hear it from the lips of someone who was there. And it's going to be glorious. But at this point in time, I'm a little envious of Dr. Luke. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told them. I really don't know what I can add to that. It's beautiful. God appeared, and they went away praising God, recognizing the blessing that they had been given, recognizing the incredible privilege that had just been bestowed on them. God cares about the little guy. He cares about the big guy too. But everybody cares about the big guy. Everybody cares about the rich person. Everybody cares about the beautiful people. Everybody cares about the people. Even the people who don't smell good care about the people who smell good. But nobody cares about the people who don't smell good. Nobody cares about the shepherds and the street people. And we see this. We're going to see this throughout Jesus' ministry. The shepherds were a step or two above prostitutes and tax collectors and lepers. And Jesus is going to go to each one of them too. He's going to heal them and love them and touch them and raise their status beyond anything they've ever seen. And most importantly, he's going to save their souls. He's going to pay the price and save their souls. And it all started with a little baby in a stone trough surrounded by sheep and goats. Goats, man. And cattle and chickens. Goats are as stubborn and mean as sheep are stupid. goats are. Anyway, this is no place for a king to be born. And yet it was. And he was glad to do it. Voluntarily. At any point, he could, you know what? I'm out of here. This is too much. But he didn't. He knew exactly what he was getting into. And for the joy set before him, he endured all of it. Finally, the cross for the joy set before him. He doesn't need the earth. He can make another one. His joy, his reward for lowering himself as low as you could possibly think of going was us. So, next week, Jesus' childhood, what little there is of it. And then, the following week, I'm taking this beautiful woman in the front row to Israel. We will still have a service. We will be out two Wednesdays. Chaz will be filling in for me. He will not be continuing with this. He's going to work up something for two Wednesdays, but services will continue, but I won't be here. I'm going to take her to Israel. And when I come back, we should have lots of pictures and stuff to show everybody. And Chaz had talked about possibly doing a Sunday morning in May, where we just kind of do a message around our trip to Israel. So that'll be something to look forward to. So please, we'll be here next week, and we'll be going over Jesus' childhood, visit of the Magi, and then come on, support Chaz the next 2 weeks. So.